push on the bump for 80.
Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners.
Hello and welcome to Special Stage and round 6 of the Mintex British Historic Rally Championship. So we're into the second half of the championship, which means that points today are vital. It's pretty wet, it's pretty windy, meaning those stages are going to be quite slippery. Let's chat to some of the crews ahead of the stages today. So Nick, how are you feeling ahead of today?
Fine. I think we were all expecting a dry, dusty rally and we got the opposite, which is okay. I don't mind the wet and the mud, but I think it might be a bit severe in cases. And three runs through the stage, it might be a little bit interesting third time through, but it is what it is. We're here, we make the best of it. You know, it's not our ideal choice for probably lots of people, but we need the points, so we've got to try and get a finish. And keep positive and give it a go.
So Jason, the last few rounds haven't ended too well for you. We're hoping for a bit of a better lucky day today.
Yeah, hopefully. I can't get much more bad luck, so hopefully we've gone through that stage and we'll get a finish. You know, you get runs like this, it's the joys of the sport, and unfortunately on Epping we had an engine fail and you just can't predict these things. So fingers crossed today, it's wet and windy and mucky and horrible, but hopefully we just get round to the finish.
So Joe, how are you feeling ahead of today?
Yeah, not too bad, yeah. Weather's not ideal for us, but I'm sure if we can get through and get a top three, we'll be pleased with that.
Yeah, weather's the same for everyone as well, you got to remember. No excuse.
No excuse. I can't make any excuses now. But yes, it's going to be an unusual rally compared to a lot of the Welsh Forest, but as far as the stages go, I haven't been here before, but the character of them I'm not sure about, but if you can get, like I said, top three, it'd be ideal.
So Simon, category win for you last time. Are you feeling just as confident today?
Probably not. No, it's a bit wet and slippy. I'm not used to this place, never been here before. I did a test here, well, I've never been here before, did a test here, I don't know, 6-7 years ago. I can't remember any of it, to be fair, but what we've seen of it looks a bit slushy and everybody says it's a bit slippy, so I think all we've got to do is just get to the end, keep our noses clean. Obviously we've come here for the category win. I think our competition has decided not to come, so that's a bonus. So one reason why we need to just sort of just do our job really and just get to the end, and hopefully we'll finish up with a finish. So.
So Bob, you've not done too bad this year. Are you hoping that today's going to go as well as the last few rounds have done?
Well, yes, indeed. Obviously, the plan is, you know, to finish this event today and basically score, you know, the points that we need really, and then go into the Isle of Man for the category win if we can. The Isle of Man is classed as two rounds, so if we can finish this and finish the two rounds, then we'll become category one British champion. So you know that'll be a good thing for us. Yes, it's a hell of a place here, but we just hope that we can just toodle around today. I'm telling everyone we're going to toodle around, but everyone's saying no, that ain't you, Bob. So, but yeah, the plan is to sort of toodle around and get a finish today, a safe finish to keep the car safe and hool for the Manx really.
So plenty of crews here this weekend looking to get some much needed points. Nick Elliott led those crews into the stage, with Jason Pritchard and Joe Price both looking for a trouble-free run here at Walters Arena. On to the first couple of stages then. It will be the lead for Nick Elliott and Dave Price, but they were suffering with a suspected diff problem in the second stage and a rush to get that sorted in surface. Thankfully, after a check, it would look like the noise was just being caused by a bent wheel, so the lead was looking safe going into the next loop of stages.
So having a few issues in the first couple of stages?
Stage one was okay, and the surface was actually better than I thought it would be for the conditions. Two was really slippy and gloopy. We had one spin backwards and a driving test three-point turn to get going. But yeah, timing one was okay. And I thought it's better than it could have been, you know, considering the weather. We thought we had the diff or puncture during two. Thankfully, it's just a wheel buckled because it is, well, if it is a diff, then that's it. We're on our way home. But it looks like it's just we caught a big rock and it hit the wheel, and it's hitting the caliper, so dunk, dunk, dunk in time with the wheel going round. So yeah, that's a quick and easy fix, thankfully. Just more of the same really. Just if it's raining, if you struggle, if it's you've got a dry spell, it's a lot easier. So it's just going to be the luck of the weather really, a clear run and get to the end and see where we are.
A late entry for Joe Price and Chris Brooks this weekend in a bid to gain some points was going well to start the day. Second place for the pair, not happy with the pace, but that was simply down to the conditions in the stage. It may not feel fast, but the pace was clearly there.
Getting away from us, how are things going?
It feels really slow, really slippy, mud this on top of the road like that. And so I don't know how we're getting on, but it doesn't feel very good.
Yeah. Still here.
I'm here, so that's the main thing.
It feels the same for everyone,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, no, I'm sure it does, definitely.
Steve Bennett and Paul Spooner would be another crew feeling the same as Price. The pace felt slow, the car bogging down in all the mud, but they were still managing to lie third at this stage.
I think today's certainly an experience, isn't it? How are things going?
Yeah, it's very, very slippery, as everybody before me has probably said, but we're struggling. The car's bogging down a little bit. I don't know if it's just there's so much mud, it's bogging. But it doesn't seem to be really sharp. But yeah, I'm sure it's the same for everybody. You're saying the same thing.
Yeah.
Too slippery, but there we are. It's good fun.
Matthew Robinson and Sam Collis were back for some more miles in the car ahead of the run in New Zealand later in the year. But these certainly wouldn't be conditions they want to see out there. Fourth place for now and struggling just like everyone else.
Let me guess, it's wet, it's muddy, it's slippery.
Yeah, and there wasn't much grip of any kind really, so yeah. Didn't do well. We had a skid round and it's put a few miles on, but I wouldn't have thought we're the fastest by any means. Yeah. But yeah,
the car feels all right.
Yeah, not too bad. Yeah, it'll be same for everybody. It's not a lot of grip.
Yeah.
So.
Have a good day.
The record in recent events hasn't looked good for Jason Pritchard and Phil Clark, so a finish this weekend was priority. A win would just be a bonus. For now, the pair lie in fifth, just struggling through to get those points.
What are the conditions like on the stages then?
Terrible. Probably the worst I've ever had. It's not enjoyable at all. It's just aquaplaning everywhere, going up the straights, going into corners. You just can't get a feeling at all for the car. And there's a couple of times I thought we had punctures, and then I think the back wheels are getting full of muck and you just hear it grinding and it's just bogging the car down. It's not fun, but we've got to do it.
Ben Friend and Cliffy Simmons hadn't been in the car for a while, and this would certainly be a tricky return to the stages. They're of course finding things the same as everyone else, but just driving to the conditions and getting around as best they could. With stages this slippery, it meant that power wasn't everything, and the pair managed to end this loop with sixth place overall and leading the way in the D3 class.
130. Come on! Caution! Four left into narrow two right. This is good. Into five left, which is flat. 60 down the hill. Two left, long. Into three right plus. In. And flat, six left out of it. 60. Two left, narrows over junction. 40. And flat, six right, up the hill. Yours off, pinto bit. Flat, six right, go on mate, 100. Absolutely flat, five left. Continues for 150. 200. This is why it's a BDA stage, isn't it?
Yeah.
At the top, yeah. Turn right, square left.
Sliding around, I can imagine.
Yeah, it's not the best conditions, but we're making do, so.
Yeah, how's the car feeling?
Yeah, not too bad. We haven't been in it for a little while, so it's just getting back used to it, really.
Been these stages before?
Yeah, we've been around here a couple of times before, so
yeah,
it's pretty good.
A bit of an advantage on some people.
Yeah, it's not too bad, so.
Two crashes in the last couple of events would mean Simon Webster and Jez Rogers were taking a cautious approach. The conditions were not helping that, though, and they end this loop with seventh place for now.
Through the first two stages then?
Well, incredibly slippery, very boggy. I expect everybody's saying the same. You can't really feel where you are, and I've got to admit, I've got no confidence in it at all at the moment. No, I took it very steady through there, so it's haven't had two crashes in the last two events. I don't want to do it again.
No, not the greatest event or weather to build your confidence, really.
No, it's incredible how it just rains here. It's we'd have been better with a boat, you know.
Guy Anderson and Stephen Davey make a good start to the event. They lead the way in the D4 class at this stage, looking to gain some points ahead of the next round in the Isle of Man. Tim Freeman and Paul Williams were not fans of the slippery conditions, finding it hard to keep it on the road, but they make it through to end this loop with ninth place.
You're looking a little bit scared. Is it slippery out there?
Very slippery, yeah, it was horrible. Yeah, it was hard to keep it on the road. Not the best of conditions. No.
But everybody's in the same boat.
Well, yeah, they are. I feel sorry for you two stood out there, really.
And rounding out the top 10 at this stage were Gareth Lewis and Mark Crisp, taking it steady in a bid just to get round the stages. But the times were okay, putting them in the middle of the results still.
Talk me through the first two stages then, what were they like?
Desperate. But we're okay, yeah. We're back in one piece, so we just took it a bit steady just to try and get round it, really. But it was very tricky. Yeah.
Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners. Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners. Just outside the top 10, it would be 11th for Terry Brown and Den Golding, having problems with the understeer and the thick mud, but they just want to get the car round in one piece.
How are things going out there?
Oh, very, very slippery. Very slippery. Yeah. Even losing the front end of the cars, the mud is so thick down there, you know, so it's survival, really.
Brown only had 2 seconds of an advantage over Mike Tomkinson and Sean Whitehurst for the class and overall position. Tomkinson thinking they had a puncture in the opening stage because the mud was that bad.
I'm sure we won't be the first to say rather slippy. We thought we got a puncture in the first one because it was so slippy. But yeah, second one got into it a little bit more. Can't use the throttle as much as you'd like, that's for sure.
Jason Gardner and Graham Cox lie a little further back, 14 seconds behind Tomkinson at this stage, trying to pick out the places with grip and make up some time there.
How are things going?
Very slippy. Like being on ice, really, out there. I don't know if we've got the right tyres, but there it is.
Yeah, everybody's in the same boat, though, so I can imagine not a lot of speed. How is the car feeling in the conditions?
All over the place in places, really. It's quite treacherous. Some places you get grip, some places you're just nothing at all, so just take it steady and get through the day, really.
Rex Ireland and Adrian Scadding will only be 3 seconds back from Gardner on the overall times. They also take up third place in the D3 class after stage two. Barry Stevenson-Wheeler and John Pickovince were finding some bits of the stage to be good. The trouble was that some bits were bad, and knowing where to find those bits was a lottery. They get through for now and in 15th place.
How are things going?
Tough. Look at the state of me. That's tricky, very tricky that is. Nearly went straight on a couple of times, just on the brakes, really muddy. Yeah.
Not feeling too confident?
I think the trouble is you feel a bit of grip, so you get confident, and then there's a bit where there's no grip, and that's, you know, so I think we'll just try and get a finish today. I think that's the name of the game, I think.
Fingers crossed.
Yes, thanks, yeah.
David Kinniston and Andy Russell were fairly new to gravel, preferring the asphalt, so this weekend was going to be a real test. They get to the end of stage two with second in the D4 class and 16th overall.
Same for everybody. It's very slippery. You've heard that 1,000 times. Yeah, it's very, very good. Yeah, and learning something.
Yeah, steep learning curve today, yeah. Isn't it? Is it your first time on these stages?
Yeah, I've never been here before. Yeah.
How are you finding them, other than the rain?
Obviously, they're designed for rallying, aren't they? They're perfect in a nice, dry environment.
A spin and stall in the opening stage wouldn't help the times for Tom Coftree and Jamie Edwards, but they're not confident the times would have been there anyway. 17th place for now and second in the F2 class.
A tough two stages, I can imagine.
Yeah, we spun on the last stage and stalled there. It's very difficult keeping the car pointing in the right direction. Yeah. It's very, very slippy.
So that lost you quite a bit of time, did it?
Yeah, we did. But to be fair, I don't know what time I lost the first stage. It was, I mean, even on a straight, you're trying to accelerate, the car was doing kind of tank slappers along it. So it's the same for everybody, but it is very, very slippy.
Paul Holmes and Elgin Davies would be one of a limited few who were actually enjoying the stages. It wasn't helping the times, but they were having fun. 18th place for now.
How How are things going then?
Yeah, really good. Very slippery, very wet, very exciting. It's good.
Good stuff. I'm glad you're enjoying it. Yeah, have you done these stages before?
Never been here before, no, but Elgin has, so he's familiar with it.
Yeah, well, that's a bit of an advantage, I can imagine.
Well, I think so. Should do.
A wrong turn in the complicated network of stages for Ron Hall and Phil Spilstead means they get caught by a car and round out the category results in 19th place.
How are things going?
Good, very slippery.
Yeah, so you're enjoying it?
Yeah, it's great fun.
Have you had any scary moments, or is the car behaving?
No, we just took a wrong turn at one place, and that's why the other car caught us up, but apart from that...
So the co-driver needs a bit of work?
Yes.
So at the end of the opening two stages, the results in the RSR Historic Engineering Category 3 looked like this. In Category 2, it will be Simon Tissot and Paul Morris that lead the way. Stanley Orr not here this weekend, so it will be one less to worry about in the category. For now, it will be the lead, but a gearbox problem would need looking at in service.
How are those two stages for you?
Well, very slippy, but we've got gearbox problems. She was jammed in second most of the way round, so struggling.
Something that you'll be able to sort in the service,
we've
do you think?
We've got a spare gearbox, we're going to have to change the gearbox.
Closest rival to Tissot this weekend would be Warren Fulliskirk and Nigel Hutchinson. They lie in second place for now. They have problems of their own, having been up a bank and had a spin.
How are things going?
Well, it's very, very wet. I've never been in any stage as slippery and as wet as that in my life. We've had a bit of a spin, we've been up a bank, but we've got through. But the rain at one point, we just couldn't see where we were going. The screen's misting up, my glasses are misting up.
Certainly so, a challenge.
Other than that, we're enjoying it.
Pete Smith and Alan Cook were not avoiding the problems either. They had an eventful stage, having the car up on two wheels and almost going over. Luckily, they didn't, and they reached the end of this loop with third overall and the class lead.
What have we done? How are things going?
Fine, thank you. Bit wet and sticky and muddy and lovely in there.
How's the car?
Car's okay, we nearly had it over on its roof, but managed just to bring it back down again, so we're okay.
It would also be a class lead for Stuart and Linda Carris, leading the way in the C2 class. They knew they were not the fastest through here, but were enjoying the challenge.
How were the first two stages for you?
Incredibly slippy. It's different, it's not like a forest. I enjoyed it. But I thought I had a puncture. It just saps the power because it's so loose and slippy.
You know, a few people have said exactly that.
Yeah, but it's put a smile on my face, so what can you say?
In contrast to Carris, Malcolm Bayliss and Siobhan Pugh were not enjoying the stages, much preferring dry gravel. They get through in fifth place.
How have things been going?
Not bad. I thought I had to take a shovel with me to level some of it. It's just sapping all the power with only a 1600, so second, first, third, and then one turn in, but everybody's saying the same thing.
Yeah, so any scary moments out there?
And unfortunately, there would just be the one crew this weekend in Category 1, so that means no problems for Bob and Dale Gibbons there. They would just be looking to keep the car in one piece ahead of the Isle of Man.
About it?
Well, I think it's the same for everyone, obviously. The worst two stages I've ever done, I think. I thought I was towing my caravan round. Just couldn't get no grip. Just couldn't make the car go. No grip, no. It was understeering. I couldn't put the power down. Nothing. Just got through it.
So at the end of stage two, the results in the Capital Construction Category 2 look like this, with Simon Tissot leading the way, as long as he can get that gearbox sorted. And just the one crew in the Vintage Car Radiator Company Category 1 this weekend, all he has to do is make it round in one piece. On to the next couple of stages, and there will be a change to the lead. Joe Price and Chris Brooks now take the advantage at the top, still finding it tricky, but clearly managing to find places to push when they did have some grip. They would just want to get the car to the finish now in one piece and avoid doing anything to lose that advantage at the top.
300 up middle. 6
left continues to 100. 80, 6 right. 6 left of 100, 80, 6 right. 130. 5 left plus okay. And 6 right okay. 60, turn hairpin left, don't cut. 6 right, 60, turn hairpin left.
How are those two stages?
Very rough. I'm just trying to get around without getting a puncture or knocking anything. So yeah, it's tricky, really tricky.
You've done well, I think, just to get to the end.
That's how I'm feeling now, actually. Just keep going as we are and keep it in one piece.
The reason for some of the change at the top would be a puncture for Nick Elliott and Dave Price. They decided not to stop and change it, gambling that they'd lose less time by continuing on, and they were right. They almost got caught towards the end of the stage, meaning a minute loss, but that would of course be less time than if they'd stopped. The conditions in the stages probably meant that the puncture didn't feel much different to driving without one.
And stay wide, don't cut left 5, 130. And over dip, and don't cut right 6. Into mid-crest, 80 down, mid-crest, 80 down, don't cut left 4, into bus stop chicane on right.
How far?
Pardon? How far? You're probably about halfway through.
We're fucked.
80?
What
are you going to do? You drive it, you're going to go over 4 miles, right 1, half long, right 1. 40, left 5, and turn sudden, tight hairpin left. It ain't going that slowly, you'll lose so much if you change it. Right 3, 80. And left 2. Left 2.
Got a bit of a puncture, have you?
Had a front puncture, not far in, so we struggled round. Probably lost less time than stopping to change it, but Jason almost caught us at the end, so that's a good minute gone, so my luck strikes again, so that's us done really, but we do the last one and see if we can get salvage some points, but bit of a shame really, we're flying.
Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners. Steve Bennett and Paul Spooner try and push in the repeat stages. Unfortunately, the times went the other way. They felt that things were getting worse, so it would just be a cautious drive to the finish for the pair now.
How are things going?
I think it's actually got worse. It seems to be more slippery and more mud on the top. It's not ideal, but it's the same for everybody, so Just live to fight another day today and get around to the finish, I think.
I think a couple of people have punctures, others are trying to avoid some big rocks. Did you have any issues in that?
We drove harder and I think it was slower. I hurt my wrist on a bad hairpin. It's not the most enjoyable rally I've ever done, but no. It's the same for everyone. So there we are, we're out having fun.
Still a cautious approach for Jason Pritchard and Phil Clark too, trying to find a measure between a result and a finish. They end this loop with fourth place for now.
How are those stages any better?
Yeah, there's a bit more feeling in the car that time, but still, every now and then you just aquaplane just from nowhere. You can't predict what's going to happen around the next corner. So we clipped the one chicane just to the back corner. It's just so slippy, but apart from that, we're here and that's the main thing.
You've come in ahead of Nick.
Yeah, Nick had a puncture. We just caught him towards the end of the first stage of that loop. So, he's on the same tyres, so it's unfortunate for him. But there's a lot of big rocks being pulled out, so we're just trying to weave our way through. Yeah.
Unfortunately, this will be the last we see of Matthew Robinson and Sam Collis when they decide that the conditions were too much to risk the car, and they pull out of the event and take what they've learned on the stages away with them.
Misty and a bit foggy. Is visibility affecting you out there?
It's horrible out there. It's slippy. If you want to have a big accident, it's that slippy. The weather's spoilt, the weekend really for the stage. But I mean, I think the stages would have held up pretty good if it was dry. But yeah. So we'll go have a shoe over now and have a mess around with some tyres, I think. But yeah, we haven't got a lot of grip, so.
I don't think anybody has.
No. Well, they've got more grip than us. The clock says so.
Things were still going well for Ben Friend and Cliffy Simmons as they end this loop with fifth place. They're not paying attention to the times, just doing their own thing, and it was working. They lead the way in the D3 class and are just 43 seconds off the lead of the event.
Absolutely flat. 6 points. 100. Absolutely flat. 150. 5 left. And 200 up the hill. And at the top there, mate, turn wide, square left. And 4 right. 40. Good. 2 left plus opens long. And stay middle for turn, don't cut. 2 left opens long. Don't cut, Tim. And 3 right tightens and 4 right plus. And it does. 4 right plus, 40.
How is your day going so far?
Yeah, not too bad. It's, well, dare I say, it's trying to dry out a bit, so hopefully it'll be better this afternoon.
Yeah. And what about the car?
Yeah, car's going well. Hard to keep in a straight line and do what you want, but...
I think everybody's having the same issues, though.
Yeah, we're all in the same boat, so we'll just get around.
Do you know what your timings have been like so far?
I'm not too sure, really. I've not paid attention to them, just doing our own thing, so...
Yeah, just pull straight on and get to the end.
That's it. That's
enough. Simon Webster and Jed Rogers come out this loop happy that they'd managed to find a little more grip. It still needed some caution, but at least for now, things were looking good for the pair in sixth.
How are those two stages?
Yeah, I felt much better on those. There seems to be a bit more grip now, but still fairly scary, you know. Yeah. You just don't know when you've got grip and when you haven't. And some of the corners I found are blind, and if you're not careful, there's a huge rock on the inside, you know. So you have to be very careful.
Is visibility bad out there as well?
Visibility's okay, unless you hit one of the puddles and the muddy water goes on the windscreen.
Tim Freeman and Paul Williams were still taking a cautious approach, but that seemed to be working for them on the times. They lie in seventh place for now and fifth in their class.
How are you feeling after those two stages?
Very hot. No, that's definitely hard work. Very tricky conditions. Yeah. It is what it is.
An improvement over these stages sees Terry Brown and Den Golding a little happier with things. Faster on the second time through, but still aware they had to drive within the limits.
Still got a smile on your face.
Well, the second time was quite a bit, little bit quicker. I think we're up about 20, 30 seconds on the first one. But it's very, very slippery out there. You know, you've got to drive within your limits.
Guy Anderson and Stephen Davey were still going well on paper, leading the way in the D4 class, but the car had developed a problem in the stage, so their position and indeed their finish was now at risk.
Now, your car's not looking too healthy. Have you been having some issues?
Yeah, we're literally about halfway through that stage. The car's gone off song. We're not quite sure what's gone on. We've still got oil pressure and the temperature's good, so we maybe dropped a valve or something, but... you know, priority is try and get a finish today for the Isle of Man. That's our main thing. But obviously, you want to, if there's a problem with the engine, save the engine. So we'll see how we go in service.
And rounding out the top 10 now were Jason Gardner and Graham Cox. They've done a few things to improve the grip, and it seems to be working for the pair.
How are those two stages?
Yeah, a lot better, a bit more traction. We dropped the tyre pressures down in service. It seems to have done the trick, but... bit of understeer on the front now, so we had a couple of overshoots in the second stage there, stage 4. So we're going to work on that now, see what we can do on that for the last stage.
Times were getting better for Barry Stevenson-Wheeler and John Pickavance, but they were putting that down to them driving better, as much as any improvement in the conditions. They lie just outside the top 10 in 11th place now. Mike Tomkinson and Sean Whitehurst did feel like a line had started to clear on the stage. The grip had improved for the most part, but things were still far from over yet. For Rex Ireland and Adrian Scadding, it will be 13th place. Things were still going well in the Class 2, with 2nd place in the D3 class at this stage. Things were also going well for David Kynaston and Andy Russell too. They make some setup changes in the car and the times reflected that. 14th overall and 2nd in the D4 class. No spins for Tom Coventry and Jamie Edwards in this loop. They go for some narrower tyres and it was working, improving the times over the same two stages from this morning. Paul Holmes and Elgin Davies were still enjoying the stages, the times improving as the stages start to have a layer of mud skimmed off. They lie in 16th place now. And the problems for Ron Hall and Phil Spilstead keep coming. This time a misfire in the stage was losing the pairs some more time. So with just one stage to go in the RSR Historic Engineering Category 3, it's all change at the top, but with the longest stage to go, it could still be anyone's to win this weekend. No change to the lead in Category 2, Simon Tyser and Paul Morris still lead the way there, but the gearbox problem still hadn't gone away.
Have said that the conditions are improving a bit. Is that something that you're noticing?
New gearbox, and we're still having problems. Last time it was jumping, won't go in gear. Now it won't. It goes in gear, it won't come out. So anyway, we're fighting with the gearbox. First stage, last stage was a bit better. Conditions improving. They're a bit atrocious in there. Challenging's the word. But yeah, it's the same for everybody. It's finding that grip. Some places you got good grip, and some places you got no grip. But what we've got to do is get it to the end today, I think.
Warren Phillips-Kirk and Nigel Hutchinson have a better run through these stages. No spins, and they get to the end of the loop with that second place still 21 seconds back from Taito ahead.
How were those two stages?
Well, they were a little bit better. We didn't have any spins, but it was still very wet and slippery, but fractionally better now. We've got rid of a bit of the top mud, I think.
Yeah, and as well, maybe just getting a bit more comfortable in the conditions, do you think?
I think possibly so, yes. No, so we were a lot more comfortable in there, thank you, yes.
Pete Smith and Alan Cook have a less dramatic run this time through, keeping the car on all four wheels. The stages were starting to cut up a bit, but the times were looking better.
Slightly better conditions this time round?
Slightly.
It helps.
Yeah, it helps. It's quite rutted in places and rough, but yeah, it's good. Oh, it's good fun.
Good to see that you managed to get some better times.
Yes, quicker this time through, yeah, definitely, yeah.
For Stuart and Linda Carris, it would still be the C2 class lead. They do stall in this loop and lose a bit of time, but it didn't cause any problems to the overall times, where they remain fourth.
Conditions are slightly better now?
Oh yes, a lot better. They must have cleaned it up or something, but the first stage of those two, yeah, it seemed to flow, and I had a bigger smile than this morning. And then we made a mistake on the second stage. But not to worry, and we got it wrong and stalled it, and it wouldn't start, so we lost about half a minute. But never mind, we're still here.
And for Malcolm Bayliss and Siobhan Pugh, it would still be fifth, back to running with the heater on full to stop the car overheating, but at least that will be a bit more comfortable here than it was on Epint.
How are things going? You look quite tired.
Oh, we've got to have the heater on again. I haven't had a chance to fix the engine from last time, so with everything, it's rather warm in here. And very slippy.
Were they any better?
Not really.
And of course, with just himself to battle with in Category 1, it would still be that place for Bob and Dale Gibbons. Narrower tyres were helping them with the times overall, though.
Looking happy?
A bit happier. Yeah. Narrower tyres seem to have done the trick. Yep. Front and back. So, we put Dunlops on. We were on Pirellis, but they were too wide, and we put very narrow Dunlops on, and a hell of a lot better. Yeah. Semi-enjoy that one.
So at the end of this loop, it's no change in the Capital Construction Category 2 battle, with Simon Tyso managing to keep hold of that lead. And for Bob Gibbons, the Vintage Car Radiator Company Category 1 win was looking even closer now. Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners. On to the final stage then, and there will be no change for Bob and Dale Gibbons. They make it to the end of the event, which of course means a category win to take to the Isle of Man next time out.
Hey, category win as well, congratulations.
Yeah. Just, shame this, the competition for the category wins is down, but we just caught and passed an escort in there, which was rather good. We did it. The car's all. So we got a mega rebuild for the other man now. Yeah. So, yeah, really pleased this is behind us.
It's been a massive achievement, to be honest, to get over the finish line today.
Yes, indeed. I don't know where we are, but I'm sure we're up a little bit now. And, it's been good.
Mm-hmm. Malcolm Bayliss and Siobhan Pugh will be glad to make it to the finish of the event. They remain fifth in the class to finish and happy to be there in one piece. No change for Stuart and Linda Carris in the final stage. They reach the end of the event with fourth place in the category and take the C2 class win. For Pete Smith and Alan Cook, it would be the C3 class win. Pete would miss the Isle of Man now, the next round being his home event in Yorkshire. Warren Phyliscirc and Nigel Hutchinson keep the times looking good and holding to second place at the finish, unable to advance on the lead, but happy that they got through okay. They too would miss the Isle of Man and be back in action in Yorkshire. So that means it's the category win for Simon Tissot and Paul Morris. They couldn't quite believe it with the problems they had during the event, but the win sets them up nicely going into the final round of the season.
That was horrendous, that was. I haven't been rallying that long, but 8-9 years of rallying, and that's probably the hardest stage I've ever done.
What was so tough about it?
It was just so slippy. You just could not read where the car was. It was pulling us off into the ditches and the rest of it. But we're here, and I was just so relieved to come across the finish line. So yeah, good day. If we have had a category win, fair play. And if he's beat us in there, well, fair play to him.
So at the end of the event, the final times in the Capital Construction Category 2 and Vintage Car Radiator Company Category 1 look like this. In Category 3, there will be no change for Ron Hall and Phil Spilstead as they round out the results in 15th place. Paul Holmes and Elgin Davies would be happy with their finish of third in the class. They get to the end, although found the stages a little rougher on the last pass. For Tom Coftrey and Jamie Edwards, it would be second place in the F2 class, surprised to even make it to the finish after some of the moments through the day. For David Kinnison and Andy Russell, it would be second in the D4 class. They'd be missing the familiar asphalt of the Isle of Man, and next for them would be Rally Yorkshire. Despite the problems, Guy Anderson and Stephen Davey get the poorly car to the finish of the event without any further damage. They take 11th place overall and the D4 class win in the process. Sadly, the top of the results will take a big shake-up in the last stage. Joe Price and Chris Brooks go into the stage with the lead, and unfortunately, it wasn't to last. The pair slide wide on this corner and put the car into a ditch. Contact with the rock causing the end of the event for the pair and one to forget. On to the top 10 then, it would be Barry Stevenson Wheeler and John Pickavance that take 10th. The last stage much better after a tyre change. Now they just have to get the car ready for the Isle of Man in a few weeks' time. This will be the last round of the season for Jason Gardner and Graham Cox. They'll be glad to get through without issue, the finish being the main thing this weekend. No change for Rex Ireland and Adrian Scadding in the final stage as they get themselves second in the D3 class this weekend and 8th place finish overall. Terry Brown and Den Golding, it would be 7th. This was their last round of the season, so they'd be happy to go out with a good result to end on. Tim Freeman and Paul Williams had a tough day wrestling the car around the slippery stages. Glad it was all over, but they do take 6th place at the end of the day, which is more than they were probably expecting in the conditions. Mike Tomkinson and Sean Whitehurst score their best result of the season, with 5th place overall. They also managed to take 3rd in the D5 class with that result. The stage is starting to get a bit worse now, so they'd be glad they didn't have any more to do. Ben Friend and Cliffy Simmons have a great run, taking the class D3 win at the end of the event. They felt the grip was improving as the day went on, but they'd be happy to be calling it a day after 5 stages and not going out to do any more. The pair missed the Isle of Man. Next up for them will be the final round in Yorkshire.
Don't cut and keep 3 left over crest, narrows into 5 right. 130. Be tidy, turn 2 left long into turn, square right, don't cut. It does narrow a bit on the square right. At the top there, turn square left and middle over flat crest. Nearly there, mate. Into don't cut. 5 right's good, 130, 5 right, and 6 left, 150, don't cut, 6 left at the bottom, braking. Well done, Benno.
Well done, Cliffy.
Well done, mate.
Top man.
On to the podium places then, and for Steve Bennett and Paul Spooner, it'll be that final step on the podium. Seeing Price off in the stage did nothing for the confidence, but it did stop them going into the same ditch themselves. For Jason Pritchard and Phil Clark, it will be second. Unable to make it a win here this weekend, but the finish was a victory in itself after the run of bad luck. This would be step one into salvaging a result this season. Next stop, the Isle of Man.
The aim was to finish first, and obviously to get points to the championship is the bonus, but you know, after doing that first stage today, and my language was a bit bad at the end of the stage, it was the worst stage I've ever driven. It's horrible, with just passions the whole time, so the confidence has grown, and you know, it's nice to get a bit of mileage and finish, and that's the main aim.
But that means that despite the issues today, it would be the win for Nick Elliott and Dave Price. They take the victory by just 3 seconds from Price and bag themselves some maximum points here in Wales. The pair would not be in the Isle of Man, so Yorkshire would be their last chance to get some final points towards their championship campaign.
And 80, turn Dunkirk, hairpin right. And left 3 over crest, right 5 at 130. And turn open, square left, tidy, square right Dunkirk. Up mid, turn square left. Square left. And mid over crest into Dunkirk right 5, 130. And right 5 into left 6, 150. Into left 6, 150. And Dunkirk left 6. That's it, done. Next lap. Yeah, it wasn't that bad.
Pretty good result for you here today. You must be feeling quite chuffed given everything that's gone wrong.
Well, we're not really sure right now. Joe hasn't come through. Poor lad had no tyres for the last stage. We gave him 2 of our tyres. Obviously, our puncher on 2 was, you know, dreadful. Or stage 3, as it was. But I'm not sure the times what Jason's done. We were in front of Jason. As long as he's not chunked a big amount of time out of us, we might have clawed it back. So, first or second, I guess. Either I'll be quite happy with, considering driving 6 miles on a front puncher. I almost put it on the trade and went home, but proves you've got to keep going, and anything can happen in the last stage, like it does normally to me. But we had a clean run on that one,
yeah,
so happy to get through it, and whatever I'll be happy with. So
good. Well done, you've done well today.
It's a battle back, yes, yeah. Never give up, you see, just keep going.
So at the end of a very tricky event, the results in the RSR Historic Engineering Category 3 and overall results look like this. The result in Category 2 means that Simon Tyso moves into the championship lead overall after this round, pushing Paul Barrett from that top spot and into second. He'll be looking to change that around in the Isle of Man, the championship still looking good for him at this stage.
Well, it's been a pretty tricky day here at Walters Arena. Any of the crews that finished, I think, are just relieved to have got to the end. So next up, we're heading to the Isle of Man, 2 rounds. Let's take a look ahead and see what the crews can look forward to in September.
The next stop for the crews in the Mintex British Historic Rally Championship would be the Isle of Man, the longest and one of the most demanding events in the calendar. And with the event being split into 2 parts, it means double chance of adding to the championship points total if things go to plan. Jason Pritchard clinched the title on the event last year after a close battle all season with Richard Hill. This year he goes into the Isle of Man on the back foot in the championship, but the experience certainly stacks in his favour on the event, having won the Isle of Man a number of times in both the historic event and the modern national event in May. The rally takes in classic stages the length of the island, 20 stages in total over 3 days with a total of 160 competitive miles to test the crews and make them work for those results. Action kicks off on the Thursday with a shakedown stage, one of only a couple of events in the season to allow the crews a chance to check the setup of the car and themselves on a stage representative of what they can expect over the weekend. And then the rally starts properly in the evening with a head-to-head blast around the Villa Marina stage on Douglas Promenade. The time's still against the clock, but with the added pressure of your fellow competitors sat beside you as you start the stage and hopefully behind you as you cross the line once again at the end. Once the spectators have been entertained in Douglas, it's off to the traditional Manx stages out in the lanes. A relatively short 16 miles in the dark on day one, but that doesn't mean it'll be easy. Day two is the longest day, with the midpoint marking the end of the first point scoring round, with just over 50 miles for the crews over six stages, at which point, if it's all gone to plan, we'll mean they can relax a little, knowing that they have some good points going to the second leg of the event. After a short break, the crews head back out for a blast around Castletown, another favourite with the fans, and with the night drawing in again, it's another 30 miles of dark, challenging stages for the crews before a well-deserved rest ahead of the final day's action. And the final day doesn't mean the crews can wind down yet. 60 miles still lie ahead of the crews as they leave the grandstand on Saturday morning, including two 13-mile stages to finish the event, with that final blast to the finish line finishing at the famous TT Grandstand. So with such a long and challenging event awaiting the crews, we asked what it was that made this one of the favourites of the season.
It's so close and compact, and you know, you get to start to know the locals. I've been there so many times now, and it's just a nice atmosphere. It's like a home from home. The roads are second to none in the world, you know, it's brilliant, and I prefer the tarmac and can't wait.
I've only ever been there once, and when we made our own notes and we put a car on its roof on the second stage. So yeah, it's going to be interesting.
Yeah, I actually love the Isle of Man. It's a real nice week, and you know, with the recce and the stages. Yes, it's a great place. I love it.
As always, we'll be there bringing you all of the action, and you can catch updates and news on ours and the championship's social media throughout the event.
Well, that's it from us here in Wales. Fingers crossed the sun shines on the Isle of Man. The crews have got a couple of weeks to get the car's tarmac ready. We've got a couple of weeks to dry off, and we'll see you there.
Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners.